Kulawinaka, and welcome to For the Record. Tonight's show is special for two reasons. Firstly, that this is our first ever live broadcast of For the Record, and also because for the first time on the show, we have the leader of the Social Democratic Liberal Party, Maramambale Narokoto Indoketi, Rote Mumu Kepa, in studio with us. Our panelist tonight is Joshua Tuere from the Fiji Sun, and we'll get right into it. Rote Mumu, firstly, thank you very much for making time for being with us on the show tonight. I'll get right into it. In recent days and weeks, there have been a lot of comments coming out of SODELPA and also by party member Lesini Ngarase, which has painted a picture that makes it seem that the SODELPA is aligned more towards the indigenous community, and some are even saying that SODELPA's policies are racist. Is SODELPA a racist party?
I think it's the media, Edwin, more than anybody else, who's giving out this message that SODELPA is racist, because our platform has always been that we look after the indigenous issues and interests. Whilst we look after the interests of the indigenous, it doesn't mean that it overrides interests of any other group or any other people who live in this country. But because the indigenous is very special, because they're the first people that arrived in this country, and they were here occupying the land and the Ngoli-Ngoli long before any other group came here. And we just need to ensure that their interests are safeguarded. Also, it's safeguarded under the Universal Declarations, which is the UN Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People, and the ILO 169. So that covers the areas that the indigenous should be protected, and that's what we are doing.
Well, you mentioned the UN Convention on Indigenous Rights. Fiji is also a signatory to UN Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. Mm-hmm. And the supreme law, or supreme, the mother of all documents for the United Nations, is the UN Convention on Human Rights. All men and women are equal in all senses of the word. If SODELPA were to win the elections and bring in policies which are more aligned to the indigenous, wouldn't it be a breach of other UN conventions, UN Convention on Human Rights, UN Convention on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination?
You know, whilst the racial discrimination declaration is there, and also the human rights, that doesn't mean that any of those rights override any of the other rights, including the indigenous rights. We just have to ensure that all the groups are looked after, and they've been very well looked after all these years up until now. So there's really nothing racial about it. We just have to look after the groups, because they're special interests of these different groups, just like the special interests for the for any other group. So in this case, it's the indigenous. And because this is the country that they are indigenous to, and there are only 500, I've been telling this all the time, there are only 500,000 of us. You go to India, you have millions there. You go to China, there are maybe billions there. So in this country, they will be looked after as indigenous. When they go to another country, we don't expect them to you request for any rights that the indigenous in those countries might have. Mm-hmm. But in this country, we have to look after them.
You said 500,000 Fijians. Mm-hmm.
There are indigenous Fijians.
500,000 indigenous Fijians, it's okay. Mm-hmm. There are even less Indo-Fijians in the world.
Maybe Indo-Fijians, but you know, the whole of the Indian subcontinent, because you have people there that are of the same origin. So, you know, we don't look at you or anybody else as different. We are, I think we just have to ensure that the indigenous, because there's no other place where they will be looked after.
There's no other place where Indo-Fijians or anyone else who's born in Fiji.
We will look after you as we have been doing all these years.
Shouldn't that mean that I, as an Indo-Fijian, have a right to the same rights as
you have. You have every right to being, you know, live in this country as we do. But Edwin, you can't deny the indigenous rights.
I'm not denying anything. I'm just saying, why should I be treated as a second-class citizen?
You're not second-class. You know, we are all citizens of Fiji. In the 1997 Constitution, it talks there about equality. Equality of everyone before the law. Now, we also say that in the SODELPA Manifesto, equal rights and freedoms. And in this case, we look at the indigenous rights because it's there for the protection of their language, their culture. There's no one else in the world that speaks this particular language. Professor Subramani has said that, you know, if the Fijians do not keep using their language, and he's an expert on world languages, and he said that if Fijians do not keep speaking their language and writing and using it for dance, it will be lost. So there you are, Edwin. You wouldn't want to
I'll
be responsible for that.
Just adding to Edwin's question, how then do you account for the strong language coming out online from people purporting to be representing SODELPA on SODELPA Facebook pages? Basically using, and let's call it what it is, a very strongly racist language. How do you explain that?
You know, I would be very sorry to see that because I don't go to the Facebook page, unfortunately. And I would ask all those who purport to be SODELPA supporters that they keep in mind that we are here in the country to serve everyone. And we do not want to put aside anybody for whatever reason. So I'm just asking them to ensure that they have tolerance for everyone that lives here in Fiji. And please just be mindful that they have to respect
Are there checks and balances within the party to deal with this kind of behavior?
We have some websites and Facebook page that, you know what it's like, people can just start it up. We have SODELPA.org, which is our official website, but there are others before we launched that particular one. So it's a bit difficult.
if I may, let's go back to the earlier discussion about protecting the rights of the indigenous. Do you believe that the indigenous Itoke are more equal than others?
I wouldn't believe that I'm more equal than you. You might be more equal than me. I'm saying that we are all equal before the law. But some areas, you have to look after the interests of, I wouldn't say endangered species, because that would be taking it too far. But I would say that in the country where they are, anybody's indigenous, they have to be looked after in that particular country, because there's no other country that they will be looked after.
So what does this actually translate into? Are we talking about education, health, civil service? Are we talking about the indigenous population getting special treatment in these sectors as well?
I'm saying that we need to look at the circumstances where they live, because if you read the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, it does say there that the indigenous, they come through as being lacking in education, in better, you know, higher education. Also, their health issues are different from other people that live in the same country. And there are also social issues. So those would be some, you know, three of the areas that we would look at, because worldwide, that is an issue that the indigenous, you know,
so
have difficulties with.
So SODELPA does believe that the indigenous Itoke should get special treatment for what you've mentioned, education, health, and social issues.
You know, if there was any other group that needed any assistance, of course the government would put those measures into place. So Edwin, I don't know why you're coming up with the indigenous issues all the time. Because we have in the past looked after all the other groups that are here in the country. There are some groups where you have means testing, or merit-based, and then we have to ensure that with those particular areas, we ensure that they are looked after.
When you say in the past, you're referring to the
SDL
government.
That's right.
You do agree that the SDL government had an affirmative action blueprint, which did provide special treatment for indigenous people.
That's right. And that
are you going to bring that back if you are in government?
That particular one was based on the needs of the country at that time. When we come back in, we will look at what are the needs of the country, wherever they are, the different groups, and we will ensure that people are looked after in terms of the budgetary allocations, and where it's needed, we'll try and as best we can.
Joshua, we'll give you another question.
Affirmative action is sometimes seen as very top-down, a very top-down approach to solving developmental problems. Some of the critics of affirmative action describe it as a form of learned helplessness because it lowers the bar for recipients. Would you agree with an assessment like that?
I think people would have to go out and ensure that it's really well, there's a proper assessment that's done. And they need to do that not only with theory, but they need to do background checks too. Sometimes it looks very different when you're in the office and you're just getting all the facts and figures, and you're not going and doing a background check. And sometimes when you do a background check, you'll find that it's a bit different from the facts and figures that arrived in the office.
When we talk about the indigenous issues, as Sodelpa believes
your
them to be.
Your favorite one.
Well, it has. You have to admit that Sodelpa and yourself and Mr. Ngarase have been campaigning heavily using this as one of the platforms, the rights and the aspirations of the indigenous Itoke. So that's where my questions are coming out of. I'm trying to get a deeper understanding of how Sodelpa works. The question being, do you believe that you are building distrust amongst the racial communities based on how the Sodelpa campaign has been going? And you have to realize, being a leader of a political party and a high chief, if you aspire to these beliefs, this can then be translated into a totally different, a beast that's not of your making. And then you have people drawing racial lines, and you've got polarization. You've got a community, a country that is divided on race, which has been a problem of ours for many years.
Edwin, I see the media as the people who are bringing out this racist connotation. We have to give credit to the people. They are watching us tonight. They know what's happening on the ground. They hear what we are telling them. They also can make an assessment of what other people are saying and doing. So I don't think that based on what the media is saying, and in particular what you're talking about tonight, that they will base their decision on how they are going to vote. The voters out there are very, very smart. They are smarter than we give them credit for, believe me. I've already stood in 2 elections. This is my 3rd one. And I know that the voters are very, very smart operators. You can't fool them.
All right. On that note, we will take a quick break. We'll be right back. More discussions with the leader of Sodelpa. Welcome back. This is For the Record Live, and in studio with us is the Sodelpa leader, Rambale Rokotu Indriketi Rote Mumu Kepa. Ma'am, let's carry on with discussions. We've had quite a detailed discussion in the previous segment. I want to know, Laisenia Ngarase was being heavily used to campaign. He's a party heavyweight. He's very well known. He's very popular for Sodelpa, and he's been at a lot of meetings, a lot of rallies. But he's suddenly disappeared from the radar, and this coincidentally maybe happened straight after he made comments in relation to the Quran. Was there a need for Mr. Ngarase to suddenly fly to the United States?
It had already been planned, Edwin, that he was to leave at the time that that he left. You know, it's not easy to book a flight and to go off at any time that you want to go. So that had been planned well in advance. And he's a very valuable person in the party. And he's gone overseas to speak to our speak with our supporters over there.
Adam, do you think his comments were a distraction to the party? The comments about the Quran, were they a distraction to the party's strategy?
You know, I was asked that in the by one of the media people. And because I wasn't there and I didn't hear the actual recording, there was a lot of coverage in the media. But, you know, he's over there now and we are here today. So can we go to the manifesto?
Party manifesto? Yeah. All right, we'll get to that soon enough.
Hurry, Edwin.
Well, all right, we have lots of time. Did you feel that Mr. Garase may have been sort of overstepping the bounds during the campaigns?
I never feel... I don't feel threatened in any way if people are going to do what they want to do in terms of the party interest, which he was doing. And I was thankful that he was there to work in some of the areas in Suva where we had new nominees who are there for the first time, and he was able to help them out. So in that regard, he was very helpful.
The political parties, a wide range of them, we're talking about the NFP, the PDP, and the Fiji Labour Party, did consequently come out to condemn the comments that Mr. Garase had made. And now one of them, the Fiji Labour Party and its leader, Mr. Chaudhry himself, said that he did not believe in the comments made by Mr. Garase, not just in relation to the Quran, but also in relation to the common identity. Mr. Chaudhry firmly believes that Fiji is for everyone, for all its citizens, and there should be a common identity and equal citizenry. So DELPA is working on a coalition with the FLP. How do you see this coalition working if the two parties, if SODELPA and the FLP, have such diametrically opposed policies?
We have agreed to work together after the election results are out. In terms of our policies, those that we have in common, we will again look at, and if we have any differences, then we will try to work through those. But because that undertaking has been made, I think we honor it. And we will try, we will get to that point after the elections.
Well, I mean, it seems a bit confusing because...
He's entitled to his opinion.
That's the party policy. It's a party policy. It's a belief of the Labour Party, a fundamental belief. And so DELPA has its own fundamental belief. How do
I know that
change?
We've had some differences in policies. We will look at the areas of common interest, and those that we have differences with, we will look at it and try to sort it out. I mean, try to work through it.
All right, just fine.
I'm interested in cohesion within SODELPA at the moment. At the launch of the One Fiji Party the other day, I noticed a few prominent former, I think, SODELPA youth officials. Is there a reason? Is that a defection of sorts?
Who is this, Joshua?
I saw Ilyasa Weiss, Vani Ratanasinghe, so it was interesting for me to see their presence at the One Fiji.
Oh, One Fiji. One Fiji, Filimonde Wasarongo has started up. He's one of the founding members of that that party. And I believe that there are other, maybe one or two young people that are there with him.
So, madam, do you think there is dissension within the ranks for the SODELPA youth?
I think, you know, you're free to move wherever you want to move to. People have done that, you know, for whatever reason. So I cannot say why they would have moved to with Filimoni. That's me. You've mentioned two. I know there are many more that that are there in the office on a daily basis from the youth group.
if I may pick up again on the issue of a coalition, When you say you're going to work on these issues, are you saying that SODELPA is open to reviewing its policies so far as the rights and protections of the indigenous population you speak of? Are you open to reviewing this stand?
You know, I wouldn't want to commit myself here at this stage. We will have to look at what is negotiable in terms of their policies and our policies and try to work through them as best we can. So we cannot make any promises other than after the elections, we will look at a coalition. If it works out that there will be a coalition, then that's the way we'll go. If it doesn't, then...
So a coalition is not set in stone?
We haven't signed anything. So at the moment, we have been discussing.
Do you feel that the chances of a coalition are dwindling?
I wish I had a crystal ball right here, Edwin. I would look at that crystal ball and be able to tell you exactly what's going to happen.
Joshua? I've asked my relevant
question. Okay. Well, the policies of SODELPA and SDL are very much aligned. Do you feel that we're going back into yesteryears where SDL and FLP were at loggerheads? They tried to form a multi-party cabinet. There was dislike. I wouldn't say hatred, but there was a lot of dislike between the leaders of the two party and members in cabinet and members in opposition from both parties. There was a lot said. Multi-party cabinet failed. What chances do you have this time around if SDL and SODELPA are the same animal under different names?
You know, Edwin, a lot of water has gone under the bridge. We have had experiences, shared experiences, from the time of the coup until now. We have different people in the party, and we have said that we will try to work with them as best we can. I think that's we can't keep thrashing that same horse, eh? In terms of policies, our policies that have worked for us in the past, economic policies, the other policies that we have in terms of social welfare, agriculture, because it has worked in the past for us, and we see that these are the areas that the people are interested in, and we have gone along with that. And you know that with manifestos, it's not set in stone, as you know had mentioned. They are here as very much the guidelines that we will use once we get in. We'll see, because we don't have any Auditor General's report. We don't know exactly what the finances are like in the Ministry of Finance, but our economic policies are there, and we will try to work with it as best we can. We have promised that we will provide a 50 million subsidy because the poverty levels in the country are very, very high.
All right.
And we realize that we need to look after that particular segment of the community.
With that, we will take another quick break. We'll be right back with more discussions. Welcome back to our live broadcast of For the Record. Sorry about that. Now, we'll carry on with discussions. We have with us the leader of the Social Democratic Liberal Party, Rote Mumu Kepa. Rote Mumu, just going back into discussions, there's been a lot of talk and a lot of counterclaims and public debate, not just online, not just on Facebook and such, but people sitting around at home talking, and people publicly writing letters to the editors' columns. And do you see the differences of opinion coming out and how the country is divided on these issues of the indigenous population and the rest of Fiji? Do you recognize that there is a divide?
You know, Edwin, people that write into the papers, they write in according to what their interests are. And I'm always interested to find out what people are writing to are writing about in the papers. But you have to remember there are also many, many more people out there that have their own opinion, that are readers of the papers, but doesn't get that doesn't get into the papers. So this sample, sometimes you have to be aware, you know, of if there are particular issues that they speak on, and just take it on board and see what you can do about it in terms of putting it into perhaps what you're going to be addressing once you get into Parliament.
Madam, there's been a lot of talk about the role of chiefs in politics. It's been an ongoing discussion. Do you think the Bunora should vote for you because you're a chief? Or the paramount chief?
You know, with that question that you've asked, Joshua, I'm really disappointed that our other guest who was supposed to have been here tonight, the party leader of Fiji First, is not here, because this is one of his favorite I don't know what, that he likes to speak on. But in terms of the people of Rewa and my standing as a candidate in that in their area, it's really up to them who they want to vote for, because they are, because this is one constituency now, so we can't say that there's just one person that they need to vote for, or perhaps two, as has happened in the past. So they are free to vote for anyone that that they want to vote for, and they do know that.
Are you, is Sadelpa in agreement with the one man, one vote system that we have this time around?
We have to work with whatever the decrees dictate to us. And in this case, it's one constituency, and we try to work with it as best we can.
If Sadelpa wins, do you see Fiji going back to communal voting?
That particular issue, we have not really discussed. We will get there when we get into Parliament and then see
Sadelpa
how it goes.
Sadelpa has been quite strong in the 1997 Constitution as a frame of reference for a lot of the arguments. How do you propose Sadelpa brings that back, should it be in government?
Well, one of the areas that we have been speaking on is that the 1997 Constitution, by the Court of Appeal in 2009, we will take it back to the courts to determine the validity and legality of that decision and see what the courts have to say about the 1997 Constitution.
So Sadelpa has said that a number of decrees would go. Do you recognize that you're setting yourself up for a huge, huge legal battle? I mean, these things can't just be put aside. They exist, they're in place, and it would take up to any number of years in court to get these resolved. Do you?
We do know that the difficulties are there, and the writers of the Constitution, or the authors of the Constitution, have set it up to make it as difficult as possible to make any amendments to the Constitution. We are very well aware of that, and that it won't happen in our lifetime. We know that there are people who have the very have very strong views on this particular issue in regard to the Constitution. So then it's up to them to carry that platform forward.
You have said that, well, Sadelpa, let's say Sadelpa has the stand that there can't be a common identity. We're not talking about indigenous rights and stuff. We're talking about all Fiji citizens being Fijians. Do you still hold firm to that belief, given that we were all born here, we are all citizens of this country, and we call Fiji home? I call Fiji home. I don't know any other homeland.
I know, and we're very happy that you call Fiji home, Edwin, and I'm happy that so many other people call Fiji home. And when we meet overseas, it's like meeting your brother or your sister. Even though you don't know them, you haven't met them in the past, you just go Mbula, and everybody says back Mbula. So in that regard, you know, we are happy that everybody calls Fiji home. And we would want everyone to be happy in their homeland. In terms of the word Fijian, the word Fijian goes back to the indigenous people, we keep on going back to the indigenous Edwin, because they were the first people who arrived here thousands of years before Christ. And the documents that were written, the books, particularly by the missionaries, they write there that Fiji and the Fijians were used long before secession, and secession was 1874. So in that regard, we have a very special regard for the word Fijian.
We've come a long way from then.
I know.
We're trying
it's
to
build. It's still very close in our heart, and you are very close in our heart.
Do you see? Do you
Edwin.
See the difference between ethnicity and nationality? Ethnically, I may be Indo-Fijian, but as a nationality, I recognize myself as a Fijian. I don't see any difference between you and I, so far as our nationality is concerned. Why can't I be a Fijian?
I don't see any difference between you and me too.
Then why can't I be a Fijian? I would feel very proud.
I think, Edwin, I think this is a this is an issue that is very close to your heart, I can see, and very close to mine. Now, if we spoke about this and sat down and talked about it with other people before it was suddenly imposed on us, as it has been done, then you have that resistance. If this was brought around, you know, why don't we talk about it? We can discuss it, and it's discussed in different communities.
The problem is this was brought in by the Bainimarama government.
No, not particularly by the Bainimarama government or by anyone. The fact that it was imposed on us, and it came about as a decree that none of us knew about. We suddenly found out that there was a decree saying that everybody was to be called Fijian, and then another decree saying that native will be now Itoke. Edwin, you know the Fijians, the indigenous Fijians. You know us. If we have something, and we see that somebody else needs some of it, we'll gladly give it. As long as, if you come and you grab it, now that's another story, as has been done here. They just came, imposed this decree on us, never told us that there would be a decree coming out, and this is what the decree says. And of course everybody, I mean all the indigenous Fijians found it intolerable. But had they gone about it the proper way, and these people, the authors of the Constitution and the authors of the decrees, they have lived in Fiji for a long time.
So
they know. They should have come and just asked the people who own the...
You are Fijian. Joshua is Fijian. I'm not.
You can be a Fijian, Edwin. But as long as we just talk about it in discussion.
I can be a Fijian, but you I can't be recognized as a Fijian.
You can be a Fijian. We sit and talk about it, and everyone is happy about it.
Is Sodelpo willing to change its stand on this? I mean, if you find, if you believe that Fiji is ready to call everyone who was born here a Fijian, will you change this stand? Or are you just saying this because you know we're going into election and you're trying to appeal for votes?
I never ever change my stance before elections. I say what I want to say whenever. I never look at whether it's before the elections or after or whenever. I feel that we just have to remember, Edwin, that there are certain things that belong to different people. And this word Fijian belonged to the indigenous Fijian.
The word had, was given by...
Had, just listen, Edwin. Had the people who were the authors of that particular decree, had they asked in the different communities, gone to the different churches, brought it up in schools, given us time, We would have looked at it differently.
If there was discussion, would you have been in support of it? You, Sodelpo would have, from what I'm hearing, from what I'm gathering from you, Sodelpo would oppose every Fiji citizen being called Fijian.
I think you're getting the wrong end of the stick.
Would you support if there was discussion?
If there were proper consultations, we would look at it, and there would be some things we would agree to, and other things we would not agree to.
Yes or no, would you agree to all Fiji citizens? If there were consultations, yes or no, would you agree to all Fiji citizens being called Fijian?
If there were proper consultations,
simple,
right around,
a simple
no,
yes
I cannot
no.
answer very simply like you want me to do. And it has to go through the proper Fijian forum. So
if
I cannot
you had the
just,
opportunity to be part of this consultation and make submissions to have yourself heard before a committee or whatever it may be, what would your proposal be? Would you support all Fiji citizens being called Fijians?
I think we would have. I wouldn't want to commit myself here in terms of some other issues that will come into that
Do you personally believe that I have a right to be called a Fijian and be recognized as a Fijian? Do you personally believe that?
I personally believe that we have to look at the 1997 Constitution, because in the 1997 Constitution, there are special rights and privileges for Fijians, indigenous Fijians, and also their group rights. So it's not a simple question of yes or no, do you agree or not? Because there's entrenched legislation in here in terms of the indigenous Fijian. If we can work around that, have discussions, consultations, Edwin, I'm sure we would come to some understanding. But to have straight out yes or no, because they are group rights, they are individual rights. They are entrenched legislation in here in terms of the word Fijian as an indigenous, individual rights, group rights. So I cannot say yes or no.
All right. I think there's also we need to
take a break.
There's two parts to this question. One is what we call ourselves and what others call us. And because as Fijians, when we look at Australia and the U.S., all we know there are Australians and there are U.S. citizens or Americans as well. How do you solve an issue like that, especially in the context of one former prominent sportsman who's here locally at the moment playing across at the West? What then do you call him? What do the media refer to him as?
We were talking about Vijay Singh, the golfer. He's known worldwide as a Fijian.
Yes.
Do you agree?
So where I am basing my discussion is on the 1997 Constitution. So it's not a straight out yes or no, because there are certain rights that are here in the Constitution in terms of the group rights, individual rights, and the entrenched legislation. That's why we have those difficulties.
You're referring to the 1997 Constitution, but the reality is we have the 2013 Constitution, and that gives every Fiji citizen the right to be called a Fijian.
All right, there's the 2013 Constitution. This will be determined once you get into Parliament, and we are going to take this case through into the if and when the Court of Appeal or the Supreme Court determines that the 2013 Constitution is the Constitution to go with, then we will rest our case there.
All right, we'll take a quick break. When we come back, more discussions with the Sodelpo leader. Welcome back to For the Record. We're talking with the leader of the Social Democratic Liberal Party. Now, ma'am, before we went on break, we had discussions quite lengthy, but let's start off on a new topic. The Sodelpa Manifesto does make reference to God. Do you feel that Fiji should be a Christian state?
We have in our manifesto that we are looking at Christian values and principles. And in saying that, we also look at the freedom for any other religion to be practiced in the country. So Christian state, no. Values and principles, yes. That's what we
How
have.
How does that translate into running a government?
As it has been performing in the past. All other governments have been having prayers. At times they have interdenominational worship. So it's up to... there's nothing new in Christian values and principles, because past all governments from independence up until 2006, and perhaps this government has been.
It has been done. I mean, they have prayers, they masu before their meals, and they open official ceremonies with a prayer.
That's right.
even though they're a secular state. So why if that's even, the situation...
Even though it's a secular state, what do you mean a secular state?
I mean that the government does not give preference to any religion.
Or this particular government?
Well, as it's said in the Constitution, it says all religions are treated as equal. Okay. There is no special treatment given to any particular religion. So you would come in and you're not going for a Christian state, but your government will aspire to Christian values. Is that what you're saying?
We've never said that we want Fiji to be a Christian state. The SDL manifesto and also in the SODEL panel, we look at Christian values and principles. And that is a historical fact that we that is based on because of the early missionaries that came and Christianized the country from heathenism. That's in the 1997 preamble. That when the Christian, when the missionaries came, they changed the people. And the people that were here at that time were just the indigenous. Changed the people from heathenism to Christianity. So from that time until now, we have the Christian values and principles that we abide by.
It's funny how a lot of the discussion, a lot of your policies or your stand and what's in your manifesto goes back to the indigenous. Makes
because
me
we
think.
We were the first in this country. Well, you can't take that fact away.
Does SODELPA support discrimination then? Do you support discrimination on the basis that what the indigenous should come first?
What we are saying is Christian values and principles. And any other group or any other person can practice whatever religion they want to practice, whether it's
Everybody's
Hindu.
Everybody's practicing whatever religion they want to right now. There is no need to go that one step further and give Christianity a special treatment then.
We feel that there is a need. And that's a principle that we abide by. We believe that we should abide by Christian values and principles, as has been operating in the past.
Maybe so I could, Christian maybe I could jump in here and say the church, the Christian church in Fiji, has not had a very good track record from 1987. It has lent its support ideologically and theologically to coups and to nationalist movements. How does SODELPA propose to deal with that and with that pressing issue?
Unfortunately, that was the case in 1987 with the Methodist Church. I believe now that they've moved on from there. They've learned that that was not the right thing to do when a coup takes place. So I think they've moved away from that. And we don't... espoused by Methodist principles, we're looking at the broader Christian values and principles.
Why not leave religion to the people? Why should the state recognize any religion?
That's the policy of the SODELPA, that we would look at Christian values because it served us very well in the past.
So
you take that away, you have to put something else in its place.
So
and we don't propose to put anything else.
Recognize Christian values, preferences for the indigenous, and you saying that SODELPA is not supporting discrimination.
You can practice whatever you want to practice. Hindus can practice whatever they want to practice. Muslims, Shintos, Confucius, anybody. As long as they abide by the law, as we've had for generations, Edwin. You know, nobody's had any problems with people practicing their religion. And even in the holidays, you have Diwali holiday, which we all enjoy. You have Prophet Muhammad's birthday, which we also all enjoy. So we've been able to practice our own religion very well in the past. So I don't see any difference in the future.
Mm. You mentioned earlier about the Methodist denomination. Which Christian denomination do you feel should take prominence?
None.
Then why should any religion take prominence?
Because Christianity. Christianity first arrived here in Fiji.
All right. Now let's.
We always go back to historical facts, Edwin.
It seems we will. It seems we will.
because
let's carry on with discussions.
It stood us very well in the past,
I understand.
And I'm sure it will in the future.
I understand it. The Goli Goli Bill, you recently said a few days ago that you're going to bring that back. Can you state clearly and emphatically in what sense and in what form?
All right, the Goli Goli issue, it's not a bill yet. It was a bill in the 2006.
It was a bill
at that time. In this regard, we don't know what shape or form it will come in. We know that the Goli Goli is an issue and it will continue to be an issue. Because, Edwin, I have to go back to history. Eh? I know you don't like me to keep going back to history, but we have to go back to history. In 1874, the chiefs, 13 of them, ceded Fiji to Britain. And when they ceded Fiji to Britain, it was the land and the Goli Goli. All right, fast forward, 1970. When the instruments of secession was, when the instruments of independence was returned and Prince Charles came and what was given back was the land but not the Goli Goli. The Goli Goli was given to government. And that's where the problem has been, the ownership. We know that the chiefs and the people own the Goli Goli as they do for the land. Because it was not returned to their rightful owners, which is what the Goli Goli bill in its eventual form will become, that is where the issue is. And I believe, Edwin, since you brought up the Goli Goli issue, that the difficulty that it had in the past in 2006 was that it was not properly marketed to say that we are just trying to return the ownership. It's nothing else. We're just trying to return the ownership in terms of who really owns the Goli Goli. And the people who own the Goli Goli know that it makes great returns for the government. And they would continue to want to ensure that it's making good money.
In terms of ownership,
that's where the issue is.
I think it's probably going to cause a bit of angst, especially amongst the tourism operators who have previously been on record saying they oppose any sort of reintroduction. What would you say to that?
You know, Joshua, I think what happened at that time, in 2006, there were people going around and telling the resort owners that you have to be very careful of these people. They're going to come and fish here and take away your boats. And it was really scare tactics. So in that regard, it was very unfortunate. That's why I said we have to market it better. Make sure that that all the stakeholders know exactly what's in it for each one of them. That nobody loses out and nobody gets more than their fair share, so that it's properly worked out.
So if the Goli Goli bill comes to be, mm-hmm. and ownership is returned, don't you see a situation where a landowner could come in, or any number of landowners could come in and ask for their Goli Goli back? Wouldn't this spell the demise of the tourism industry? We could have operators who have to shut down overnight.
That's where consultations have to take place, Edwin.
But do you see that this could happen if
Goli Goli bill comes in? No, I don't see that happening, because I know that the people who live by the sea, who are the owners also of the Goli Goli, they know that the sea is there. You know, for people to use, they see the tourists coming in and enjoying it like they do the surfing at Tabarua, which is making millions of dollars. But in this regard, Edwin, in terms of ownership, we just have to be fair. And I think it's what is fair when you own something and it's taken away from you, for it to be returned.
The
consultation.
The Goli Goli bill was one of the contentious issues for the RFMF in 2006. Is this a wise move?
Going back to what I said previously, there has to be wide consultations. And I believe that they were wrongly advised at that time. Whatever information was given to them was the wrong information.
All right. On that note, we will take another break. We'll be right back. Welcome back to For the Record. Now, before the break, we were talking about Ngoli Ngoli ownership and the possible introduction of the Ngoli Ngoli bill if Sandelpa does make it into government. Joshua, you have a question in regards to that.
In our discussions prior to the break, Rotimumu, you were talking about fairness. There is a question on the current government making fair distribution of lease money, whereas previously chiefs or those the head of the Matangale enjoyed the lion's share of that. How do you justify that?
There was a reason for that lease money being distributed in that way, because the head of the Matangale or head of the Toka Toka, in which case, you know, whoever is the owner of the land, they would have more responsibilities in terms of the way the Matangale is looked after. For example, if there was a an event that came up, an occasion, or an onga, usually in Fijian, an onga, something that happened that the Matangale would have to contribute to, the head of the Matangale would be the one that would make the most, would be giving the most contribution in, to that. And they would have to ensure that whatever needed to be done was done in terms of marriage, death, or any of the other issues that pertain to Matangali family life.
So if you talk about the Ngoli Ngoli bill and being fair to the traditional owners of the Ngoli Ngoli, wouldn't it be fair to distribute the lease money equally?
As I mentioned, there is almost always a time limit in which something has to be done in the Fijian regard. If that is not organized in time, it's not good for the Matangale, because it brings embarrassment on them that they were not able to fulfill their obligations.
But do you recognize?
So the head of the Matangale has to ensure that there is a timely visit or timely way that you look after issues that come up in regards to the Matangale or Toka Toka.
What about improving the livelihoods of landowners? If you equally share the lease mm-hmm. money, you are giving out money to somebody who may not have a proper source of income, or who may not have been getting as much as the head of the Matangale was getting, or the chief was getting. Now that person can provide for their family better. They can go out and buy better clothes for their children. It has a larger effect on the economy as a whole, but on a more personal level, it helps improve the life of an individual landowner all across, instead of helping the ones higher up on the echelons.
All right, Edwin, I have to say that for us in Rewa, we own less than 1% of all land in Fiji, so we do not come into that particular particular issue of lease accruing to landowners. Now, In terms of the lease money, you'll see that areas you will go to where there are housing developments, that has come about through lease money. So in that regard, many of the Matangalis and Toka Tokas do look after their members and ensure that they have proper housing, they have education for their children, and sometimes they even have, scholarships and other issues that they look after, employment. So it's not straight out that money is issued on a six-monthly basis. It's there for the whole Matangale to be looked after.
Would you change the equal payment system?
We would look at reviewing the system, whether it's with NLTB, or with FAB board, the Fijian institutions, they would need to be reviewed. That's what we're looking at.
What's wrong with the system now?
What's wrong with the system now is that, you know, anything can be improved. So we look at that. The lease money is one of them, because that's a decree that came about in just the last few years. So that's an area too that we need to look at.
I think it's no secret that a lot of the Banua or Matangalis enjoy quite a significant amount of money when it comes to earning money from leases. Why then is there a disparity between the two major ethnic groups in terms of education? Is there something wrong within the Itauke system where the translation between the money earned and in terms of business and education opportunities, why the disparity? How would you explain that?
Not every Fijian is a landowner. The people from Lao, I wouldn't say that they were landowners. Like the landowners in the tourism and the sugar areas. So we have some Fijians that are landowners and others that are not. So, you know, that could explain some of the difficulties that they have with education.
I have vested interest here. Of course, I'm married to someone from Lao and have seen what they've done with meager resources. Is it a money issue? Do we need more money, or is it something more intrinsic that we need to work at in terms of how we...
I think the Laoans are wired differently. They're just wired differently. You're married to one, I was married to one, so I know with Laoans, they've been interested in education. Oh, 50 years ago, they were already talking about the need to have a good education. So, goes back.
Let's talk more about the political front. We spoke earlier about the possible coalition with FLP. Which other parties is SODELPA possibly able to work with?
We were in the UFDF with other political parties. The only one that we've discussed any coalition with has been the Fiji Labour Party. No other party.
Is it possible for SODELPA to work with Fiji First?
I would find it very, very difficult, Edwin.
That's the end of the matter.
There are too many differences. Their policies are poles apart from ours. We have very, very few issues that would be similar. Poles apart.
Now, the other issue has been education. This government has made education free to a large extent. You were education minister, you never did that.
Tuition fee free. That's what we were doing also. And that's what the SVT had started doing. This government has just been making more media releases on it.
You have to acknowledge that there's a whole lot more being spent on free education compared to previous years and previous governments.
Tuition fee free, it's not free education. Parents still have to buy their lunch boxes, they still have to buy their children's lunch, school bags, sandals, whatever. It's tuition fee free. In terms of that, I think where they started was just Form 7. It had already been on the track, and we had been doing that. However, what we are proposing to do is that we will start with kindergarten, so that it's from kindergarten right through to Form 7, because education is very, very important. And I'm glad you brought that up about education, Edwin, because one of the areas that many parents have been complaining about is the present curriculum, where the children are coming through in terms of literacy. They're very, very poor in it. So we would have to look at reviewing the curriculum in terms of, I think it's just too many gadgets that parents are buying their children. If you're buying your class one an iPhone or some other gadget, and they're, you know, they're playing with it, and then they learn to text. Where does that get your spelling? So we would have to really look at the parents in terms of the children's education and reviewing the curriculum.
Let's go back to when you were education minister. You are talking about education and literacy right now. Why was there a need for scaling of marks when you were education minister? Why did you support scaling of marks?
That scaling of marks had always been done. That had always been done by the previous education ministers, and we continued with that scaling of marks, and I'm sure they still have scaling of marks now. So it has stood the test of time. When we go back in, we'll see whether the scaling of marks, because the curriculum we have said is going to be reviewed, we would have to look at...
Who does it help, scaling of marks? Who does it help?
It helps the... hopefully it helps the students. It helps the school, and it helps national planning.
And would you agree that it also helps people who struggle in school, Fijians or indigenous Itoke, who don't have marks enough to qualify? Does it help them as well?
The education system will always have people that will fall through the gaps. And that's an unfortunate reality, which if you were to set a proper curriculum that's not just based on academic, that's where people who are not academically inclined will be able to be helped and supported in that way.
Right now, there is no scaling of mark. We've established that.
Okay.
Our newsroom has. Mm. And all privileges are based on merit, on marks, and all students are treated equally. Mm. Shouldn't that be the case? Shouldn't you be able to qualify for a scholarship or to carry on with your education?
All right. That's what you're telling me, Edwin. When we get back in, we would look at all the policies that are there in place and whether those policies are being followed, and then look at how we can continue from there.
There was a concern a few years ago about FAB scholarship recipients who failed, and it, I think it reached a point, something like 37%, that's a figure that was floated a few years ago. Mm. How does one address this issue? Because if we are to offer affirmative action, if the recipients themselves don't work hard enough, what do we do about that?
I think that's a real issue, Joshua, about scholarships. Now, once you give a person a scholarship, I don't think it should just end there and hope that they will work to the best of their ability. I believe that there should be scholarship offices to ensure that this scholarship is a wise investment by the government, whoever is providing the scholarship, and ensuring that the people who are holders of those scholarships are doing what they are supposed to be doing.
Shouldn't
so I believe that there should be better monitoring and better evaluation of the whatever scholarship. Because that's what happens with some of the other scholarships. It's just that the Fijian Affairs Board scholarship, in my view, was not properly monitored and evaluated.
In regards to this scholarship and to the scaling of marks, shouldn't Itoke students just be encouraged to work harder? Nothing's impossible if you work hard at it.
Nothing is impossible, Edwin. But there are so many constraints that the students have to face, and we have to help them, whether it's through FAB scholarship or whether it's through multi-ethnic scholarship, because that's worldwide. That happens. And why can't we continue to do that in Fiji? Apart from the toppers, which was just merit-based and was not means-tested, so that the people who were able to pass with very good marks were helped, but you need to also have a balance so that these people are assisted, otherwise they just fall through the cracks, they come out, they're unemployed, what's the future for them?
All right, we're just about wrapping up the show, Rotemumu. I would like to know from you, from Sodelpa, what are the 10 most important things that Sodelpa will do, the first 10 things that Sodelpa will do to improve the country?
All right, the first 10 things that we will do, We're always very mindful that a country is made up of people. And in this country, we have a great level of poverty. So we need to address poverty in terms of their basic needs, which we are providing for through the VAT $50 million subsidy scheme.
Where will the $50 million come from?
From the budget.
Find the money from somewhere.
It will come from the budget.
But it has to be sourced from somewhere. The money has to exist somewhere.
Yes. It will be there in the budget. They have to start with some money. And we are looking at that as a budgetary item. From our exports, from whatever it is that we're getting back, you know, in terms of investments, there are the loans that are there. So we will look at that and we...
Possibly just take a loan.
No. We're not going to be... There are already enough. There's already enough borrowing. But when we get in, we look at the books. The civil servants are there to look through the books. And that's going to be a budgetary item for VAT-free items. Just let me get through this. So that's one area, that $50 million subsidy scheme. We're looking at the poverty levels, unemployment, cost of living. And also because when the democratically elected government comes in, that will bring back investor confidence. We're looking at the small and micro businesses, taking away the licenses, because that's really killing these small operators. We also have a tax-free incentive for the small businesses, which is $50,000 tax subsidy. We're also looking at in terms of the sugar industry, because that's a big one with the sugar industry. Well, we need to make sure that there are consultations in terms of the European Union, because the farmers are in dire need right now. $350 million that was supposed to have been ready for utilization in 2007 because of the coup, that was taken away. And we see so many people coming in now, squatters, coming in now from the sugarcane areas. So that's where we really need to, not so much the squatter population, but you know, going back to the root cause. And the root cause is out there in the rural areas. We are looking at the agriculture subsidies that we need to provide. Mahogany is one big area that can earn money for Fiji. Instead of exporting it, we ensure that there's more downstreaming for that. And I think that's probably what I can think of right now. But the small businesses is the way to go, and investor confidence, and we're back in Parliament.
Joshua, do you have anything?
In terms, what do you say to people who are looking for some form of stability? What's your answer to ending the so-called coup culture?
I think for all of us in Fiji, myself included, we are looking for freedom. For freedom, we're looking for security. We're looking for stability. We do not want the coup culture to continue. Nobody wants it and nobody wins. Because at the end of every coup, 1987, 2000, 2006, the economy just drops suddenly. And we have many good people who leave the country. That happened in 1987. Many people left, qualified, who had qualifications, experience, expertise in the private and public sector, and they just suddenly left in 1987 after the coup. And again in 2000, 2006. I believe that we need to get to the root cause of why the coups have happened, and to prevent any coups happening in the future.
What's Sudelpa's policy and strategy on growing the economy?
In terms of growing the economy, we are looking at that subsidy that I've told you about, so that people can go back to their small, you know, try and have their small businesses. We're looking at the civil service coming back online. The fisheries sector is still quite quite healthy, and the agriculture in terms of assistance that's given to small small and first-time farmers, and that's where we really need to. And any of the young people that are out there who have qualifications from carpentry or any of the trade skills that they've had, we'll try and see if there can be some form of employment for them.
The 50 million that you mentioned, how budgets work is money has to come from somewhere. It has to be taken from somewhere and put into whatever policies you want to enact. Mm-hmm. This 50 million will have to come from somewhere. Another allocation, somebody else's budget. Mm-hmm. Have you planned it that far, or is it just something that you intend to do but you haven't really gotten as far as finding the money?
You're quite right, Edwin. But we don't have the Auditor General's report, and we haven't had one since 2007. And we are trying to find out as best we can what is the actual health of the government finances. And we've been asking the government. That's why tonight I'm very disappointed that the Fiji First Party leader is not here, because I would have asked him, you know, please, big kere kere, can you just give us the Auditor General's report? Because whilst we are talking back and forth, we have our manifesto, we have budgeted for the items that are here, but we cannot really tell you what the finances are like in government, because from 2007 we've never had an Auditor General's report.
How would you make up for a shortfall if there was a reduction in VAT? How would you make up the shortfall?
We have the finance minister who is in the SODELPA party, and he has said that there should be money in the Ministry of Finance. But just one thing, I cannot really tell you right now, because we have not seen the Auditor General's report. So if you're able to tell the Fiji First Party leader,
That's out of my hands. I was curious
That's why I wanted him here tonight, to let him know that we really need the Auditor General's report, because we can just talk back and forth.
But you can be talking. Wouldn't you have a strategy in place? I mean, regardless of the Auditor General's report, you would have to have a strategy.
We would have a better strategy if we had that. Then we would know exactly what was the expenditure, what was the expenses, what was the income. And then we would be able to let you know exactly where it's going to come from. But right now, it is a policy that we have, and we know that there is money there because the minister, our previous Minister for Finance, says there should be money there.
But you can't say how much of a shortfall we're looking at for VAT.
You are making me wonder if the government finances are worse, than we think.
On the policies that SODELPA is standing for, I mean, you make it sound as if you want to do these things, but you haven't really planned them down to the dot.
We want to do it desperately, because there is 47% of the people that are in poverty, and we desperately want to help
your strategies,
these people. Our strategies are only as good as the money that's there in the Ministry of Finance.
All right.
And because they have not given this information to anybody, it's very, very difficult. But if he was here tonight, we would be talking about it.
Well, maybe another time.
Another time.
On that note, Marambale, I have to thank you for coming in tonight, Nawalebo, and Joshua, to you as well. And I hope we've had some healthy discussions. To you, our viewers at home, thank you for tuning in. This was our first live broadcast of For the Record, and we hope you found it informative and enjoyable. We'll be back again next Sunday. I'm your host, Edwin Nand. Good night.